So good afternoon, and thanks to the speakers, and thank you to the public. We are in seven respects in times of transition. It is a time of transitions for Cosmos, who has been organizing several of these meetings and is moving from up on the hills to downtown here. And this is one of the end of the working groups on Marxism in social movements, and it is the beginning of Cosmos activities at the Scuola Normale Superiore. And I'm particularly glad to open this week of initiatives in Florence with two of my teachers, to a large extent. Mm-hmm. Teachers, not really, but I had the luck to work with these two persons for a long time. So Colin is my preferred head of department at the European University Institute. He was there when I arrived, and I could learn a lot from him on the interactions between politics, society, and the economics. He was at Oxford, then at the European University Institute, then now he retired from Warwick University, and I think that we have been always learning new concepts like post-democracies for him, but also the importance of reflecting on the relationship between political economy and societal type of developments. Wolfgang was one of my preferred teachers of methodological issues. I think it was my first research design course that I took with him in, say, 84. And also, I have to say, I've been learning a lot, especially in recent times when I started to be interested in the relationship between social movements and political economy, and I started to read more in depth Wolfgang's contributions on the evolutions of capitalism and the type of political challenges it brings about in our times. And so when we were thinking about these last initiatives of the working group on Marxism in social movements and starting initiatives of Cosmos and the Institute here at the Scuola Normale Superiore, I thought that a very good way to start was a debate among two people who both contributed a lot, also in recent time, about the discussions on neoliberalism in the crisis. And the two books, Tempo Guadagnato by Wolfgang Streeck and Il Potere dei Giganti by Colin Crouch, I think give us big contributions both in substantive terms and in methodological terms. I think they both focus attention on the big evolutions of capitalism. In times of disappearance of class capitalism, Marxism from the social sciences, I think they had the courage to pick up old concepts and trying to see to which extent they help us understanding recent development. They also have another important contribution they give us is to try to reflect on the broad common type of developments. So there had been a lot of debates about the diversities of capitalism, but from the two different perspectives, both books tend to reflect also about the common trends in our societies. And they discuss about a specific moment in which I think that the challenges for us as social scientists are particularly strong given the big changes we are facing There is a phrase, a statement by Gramsci, who is used very often and more often in recent time to open books on nowadays crisis. And it is a statement that also Wolfgang was citing during lunch. We are living in a time in which the old world is dying and the new one is not yet able to be born. So we are living in times also in which we know old categories are maybe not no longer useful to lead our thinking, but at the same time, we don't know yet which the new categories have to be. And I think that in these specific times, it's particularly relevant to reflect about these two important books, because they both tend to bring back reflections on big theories. We have been focusing a lot as social scientists on the middle range theories, or even very contextualized visions. And I think that this has brought about positive developments, but at the same time, it's a risk missing the reflections on the big interpretations, which help also different disciplines to communicate with each other. So concepts like classes, rather than just social stratification, capitalism, just rather than just economic structures. Are concepts which I think helped in the past dialogue between disciplines, and that now we have to pick up again and try to see to which extent they can help us in understanding these changes. Also, we have been accustomed to reflect on in static terms. So diversity of capitalism as a path-dependent, long-term type of trends. I think that both books address these issues of the crisis also as a moment in which we have to reflect on changes and adaptations in situations in which we don't know yet what is to be born. We don't know yet what is the new type of systems in which towards which we are moving. And times, it means also in which there is space for agencies, times of challenges because they are times of crisis, but also times in which contingencies under structured type of developments are relevant for us as scholars, but also for the citizens. And in fact, I think both books, without wanting to tell us what the future will be, but they're both there to think about the potential development, where we are going. With reflections also in search of these new concepts, which Wolfgang said, wrote, for instance, in his reflections, we don't know what will be, but we have to accept the potential, the possibilities for changes. And I think we need also this big thinking in order to articulate connections between subfields of the disciplines, which tend to be more and more separated from each other. So this is what I see as very important in these books, and both, and I would like in the first step of our afternoon together to point also to give the possibilities to Colin and to Wolfgang to address some of the general questions around which we want to organize this debate, also to debate their differences. So I said there are two books which talk to each other a lot because they tend to address the big dynamics of the crisis and to reflect on what it is that is dying and what it is that is difficult to give birth to. But they do it also with some different emphasis in calling, there is an explanation of the strength of late neoliberalism is non-death in the English title as related with the power of corruption of this type of late neoliberalism, of this capacity of the 1% or the 10% to build a very elitistic type of dominant classes and to block a normal development of crisis of a model and development of a new one. So to a certain extent, in Colin Crouch's book, the power of the giant is something which is difficult to attack because they became so strong in constructing relationship between the economic and the political power. In Wolfgang Streck's analysis, there is instead, in my view, at least more a perception of the weaknesses of this type of systems which built, which is built on the basis of a weak opposition and which risk to be victim on, of its own strength to a certain extent. So the idea that neoliberal type of development tended to stop those type of challenges to capitalism that allowed capitalism itself to survive. So the first general questions I wanted to address to both of the speakers is to which extent neoliberalism in the crisis is either a strong or a weak system from which something different can be born and what can be born from this crisis. I don't know who wants to start.
Well, you have to decide.
For the moment, I give you the
one. Right. Thank you very much, Donatella, for the invitation and for the introduction. Neoliberalism has this enormous strength, which for me is not so much the strength of the market economy, although that is its main theoretical legitimation. What we have in actual existing neoliberalism is an economy where in very important sectors we're dominated by very large corporations. And it, later in our discussion, when we look at the relationship between that and democracy, I think there are very important consequences come in the difference between a real market economy and an economy dominated by large corporations, especially in banking and in energy and in some other sectors. And part of this is a sheer political dominance that that kind of capital can have, which isn't available to firms in a real market economy. Partly it's the dependence that we all have on these large corporations, partly because they're so big. And this was the famous statement in the financial crisis that the banks had become too big to fail, which actually
and
is
too big to jail.
And too big to jail, yes. Too big, yes. Which itself is a contradiction of the theory of market economy. And the fact we've become so dependent on them and that they are global and can move to some extent, not entirely, they can move around the world to find locations where they're treated best. So there is, we have this enormous dependence, and this is the power of neoliberalism. But if you ask me to look for its weaknesses, then I would point to the fact that neoliberalism is very rarely a popular political force in the democratic sense. A few neoliberal slogans are very popular, like less taxes, fewer taxes, less regulation. But very, very rarely, almost never, do you find a purely neoliberal party dominating a democratic political system. Neoliberalism always needs a coalition of some kind. Its preferred coalition is with traditional conservatism, There is always a tension with traditional conservatism because neoliberalism is, in a Schumpeterian sense, a destructive force, and tradition stands in its way. And it opposes tradition, but it can make accommodations with traditional conservatism, and that's its preferred social compromise. A real problem for neoliberalism today is that that kind of traditional conservatism is becoming weak itself, as religion declines in importance and other aspects of traditional society, and increasingly traditional conservatism is being replaced by a much more strident, xenophobic conservatism, and an alliance between a globalizing neoliberalism and a xenophobic conservatism is a very, very difficult alliance to sustain. So I think that this is a problem that is being, that will, to the extent that neoliberalism needs democracy or has to exist in democratic societies, it has problems coming there. The other big political force that's out there is social democracy or a kind of egalitarian, collectivistically oriented politics. That clearly is very antipathetic to neoliberalism, but shares with neoliberalism a kind of openness and a general liberalism. And there may come a point where neoliberals will need to face a choice. They either continue this increasingly difficult coalition with a more xenophobic conservatism, or they run the risk of confronting a combination of sort of workers' movements that have become xenophobic, which is what will happen in Greece if the Syriza government collapses and all the supporters behind that go to Golden Dawn. The neoliberalism there faces a real choice. It might have a risk that it confronts a coalition of both its enemies. Or the other alternative is a coalition of some kind between social democracy and neoliberalism, which is what we had for a while in the 1990s and the beginning of this century in the so-called third way, in Blairism and Schroederism, and what you have today in Italy with Renzi, the Renzi government. And the issue there is whether neoliberalism or neoliberals are willing to offer enough concessions to old social democracy to provide a stable life for millions of ordinary working people, or whether though it will drive those people into the arms of xenophobic nationalism. And I think that's the point we've reached now, actually. So neoliberals face a dilemma of their relationship between a conservatism that's becoming rather hostile to aspects of the liberal agenda and a kind of social democracy. So I see that is its vulnerability, that it repeatedly has to make these compromises. And you can look at any point in time and see compromises kind of being made. The question is, how much are neoliberals willing to offer in order to buy peace for their globalizing project?
Thank you. And how much these weaknesses will bring about the potential end of neoliberalism is something you have discussed, Wolfgang, in your last book.
Yeah, not necessarily in this book, but in an article in the New Left Review, which was a lecture I gave at the British Academy, and Colin introduced that lecture. So much on the debate. I find it hard to detect disagreements in our basic analysis, but we look at different facets of the same thing. So we could sing in a choir with different voices. If it is a harmony at the end, you have to find out. I think it's pretty harmonious. Now, Let me begin by saying that looking at first of all, I won't recite my book. You can buy it. It's a very good book, and if you buy it, it's good for Feltrinelli. It's good for me. Even better for you.
And good for capitalism.
No. This is the dispensation of wisdom. What I was very impressed with when I read Colin's book, the book that we're talking about here, is two things. One, the sort of perfectly plausible analysis of a period in the history of post-war capitalism that I also touch on in my book, and this is the 1990s, where I learned basically from Colin, from reading an article that Colin had written, how this shift from public debt to private debt in a period of fiscal consolidation was accomplished beginning in the United States. It was important for me to read this because Germany is an outlier in this story. I didn't see that immediately in Germany. But then I looked at the statistics and it became clear, as always, Colin was right. that's one thing. And the other thing is his emphasis, which I sort of completely have missed in my analysis, on the large corporations, on the firms. The neoliberalism is not a system of pure markets. It is a system of global corporations, organizations that compete with each other under very, very strange rules of competition, which they work out between themselves. Today we know assisted, partly impeded, partly utilized by organizations like the National Security Association, National Security Administration, the NSA, which sort of deeply penetrates these big organizations. We also need to understand their relationship with the military-industrial complex in the United States. That's another thing that we haven't paid enough attention to. So operate a little bit differently from Colin, and it becomes clear from his presentation now. Colin speaks about, in this presentation, about the possibilities of different political ideological blocs striking alliances. Mm-hmm. And that is extremely important for the political game. In my book, I look one step upwards, so to speak, at the basic hydraulics of the political economic system, especially when we talk about democracy, about the way in which in the last 30 years, or 30 or 40 years, after the end of the post-war shotgun marriage, as I call it, between democracy and capitalism, how in this period, very slowly and gradually, the control of democratic politics over the economy sort of slipped away. That is important for the political game because what we increasingly notice, and there we are completely in agreement, is a political game that has lost its impact on the way the economy functions. So there is a separation between the two that gives rise to all, in continuing the Gramsci quote. The next sentence is, and this is a period in which all kinds of monsters appear, or phenomeni morbidi. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and a politics, a democratic politics that has no impact anymore on the outcome of markets, especially on the distribution between capital and labor, on the life chances of people, on the degree of inequality and equality in a society. Such a politics sort of produces the strangest morbid phenomena. Like you can say Berlusconi or whatever, a little bit less ridiculous, but more visible with less entertainment effect. Look at Germany. Our chancellor the other day coined the concept of the market compatible democracy. Yeah, and it is sort of it happens in a debate in the Bundestag where the question comes up: what do we do if the financial markets require fast action at the European level, maybe some rescue operation and so on? And the Bundestag sort of has this strange idea that they are supposed to decide on the budget, and they want to first hear and know what they are doing. And she says, look, this takes too long. We know we live, and this is the way she puts it. She always puts it like this. It's absolutely masterful Merkel speech. We live in a democracy. This is a parliamentary democracy, and we are glad about it. But our democracy must also meet the expectations of markets, and therefore it needs to be a market-compatible democracy. And therefore we have to change our decision-making procedures a little bit so that I can go to Brussels and actually make the promises that need to be made, otherwise the market collapses. Yeah? So here we are in a world in which we're at the end point of a long process in which more and more decisions with distributional effects on the life chances of the masses of people are taken away from trade unions, parliaments, and they end up in, let's say, central banks and international organizations where nobody understands what these people are doing. You need to study international law and the European community to even begin to understand one of those communiques that they produce overnight in Brussels. And then a paper is being distributed in Germany, sometimes in English, to the Bundestag, and they are supposed to make a decision Friday afternoon, and it is now Thursday. Yes? So there's a slippage in the way in which the and below this slippage all sorts of things get bizarre things like alliances between X and Y, but the basic fundamental thing is there is a disjuncture between what actually and then you see, if I may add this, go to the European level, and then you see a central bank that is uniquely independent, which is the European Central Bank, which doesn't even have a finance ministry to speak to, because it speaks to 18 or 28 or however many finance ministries at the same time, that has sort of constitutionally enshrined independence, and whose chief sends letters to individual governments that are not even published and tells them that what he writes to them is the content of a memorandum of understanding that they would please sign. In which you find bizarre things like you have to fire 15,000 civil servants by the end of the year. That's not even public. However, if they don't do this, something bad can happen to them. Remember this guy Papandreou and this guy Berlusconi. They were gone overnight just because their friends in Brussels decided that they should no longer govern. So here we are at a point where, and then, of course, don't misunderstand sort of the public relations exercises of these institutions. Something that one could add to Colin's last book, but it's clearly very clear from the post-democracy book, is that if in these days we're dealing with governments, political parties, and so on, we're not really listening to genuine politicians, leaders, people in touch with social movements or classes. We're listening to PR agencies. Very carefully crafted language, which doesn't penetrate at all to the core of the subject. And this, this is then sort of carefully designed to create all sorts of illusions of agency and impact. Like, for example, I find lots of people who believe that now, suddenly, the former Goldman Sachs manager Mario Draghi has turned into a sort of social democrat because he produces all this wonderful money for the Mediterranean and thereby keeps the countries going. At the same time, he keeps sending the same messages, and do not misunderstand this, the same messages of reform as a condition for the continuation of the money production. All sorts of things are being done, which the German chancellor, for example, publicly protests against, but she knows exactly that what the purpose of these operations, of these maneuvers is, namely to impose the very same neoliberal economic reforms on these countries that have always been asked for. Yeah, I understand. I have to finish here. But I do stop here. Thank you very much. And I think the point is clear, right? The point is that don't believe them. It is that political decision making of the most important kind has moved away from the everyday experience, not only of the average citizens, but even including students of politics. Last week in Torino, I debated my book on a panel together with a very, very good Italian economist, Lucrezia Reichlin. Oh. And astonishingly, we agreed on a great number of points. One point, of course, we didn't agree at all, where she, being linked to banks and central banks and having been the head of research at the European Central Bank, expressed the view that times have become so complex, so difficult, that we need to take a few things out of the purview of the normal democratic process, because the normal democratic process is overburdened by the complexities, and then we have to put them to non-political agents like the judiciary, in this case the central banks, to take care of monetary stability, economic growth, and so on, because the people don't understand the logic of this. That, of course, is something that you should be very careful about accepting, because the logic that is executed by economists and central banks is a logic not of mathematics, but of social power relations projected into mathematics. Yes, and so the political power game, the building up of power from below, which is something that we'll talk about, is able to transform this game, but it has to be done first. They can calculate, they can put all sorts of parameters into their models, including that people get very angry if you do this and that. But first of all, you have to get angry.
Yes. I don't want to push towards the differences between you, but I think there is a question which emerged from both of your interventions, left as a question mark, which is how much does capitalism really need democracy? Because I think many of the elements you pointed at are quite clear. Even countries who didn't sign memorandum of understanding were forced to accept decisions which were taken out, not only outside of the electoral accountability channels, but also outside of the visibility. So I was in Germany during the debate on the Greece case, and the people you saw in televisions talking about the important political issues were the Minister of Finances And they were those who appeared. There were also others who didn't appear but made decisions. So it is true there is a sort of loss of visibilities, loss of power, power which went from the state to the market. The parallel to Frau Merkel in Italy was Monti, who said, we don't need the trust of the citizens, we need the trust of the market. Yeah. So there is this market-compatible type of...
And he also said, I want to re-educate the Italians to become like Germans.
Yes.
That's what he also said. That was the end of Monti, thank God.
Yeah. But there is also something which I've learned from both of you, and it is the fact that neoliberalism is different from liberalism. It is what has been called ordo-liberalism. So it doesn't really trust just free market, but it thinks that you need also to govern in a strong way. And so you have, on the one hand, the need Colin was talking about for this type of neoliberalism to ally with forces who can introduce elements for the building of collective identities around non-class type of issues, so xenophobic, authoritarians, anti-civil rights type of developments. And on the other end, you also have the fact, sort of tensions between a state giving up powers to the market, but the market also needing decisions by the state. So in the past, and you have been, Wolfgang, quite explicit in the self-critique in the article published on Stato Mercato, in which you said, in the past we believed that we needed that capitalism needed democracy, but maybe it was just a parenthesis. Maybe it was the Trente Glorieuses who represented the exceptions. So I think that the questions how much capitalism needs democracy could also be bridged with what we wanted to discuss as next questions. Is there some type of alternative force in the societies that could push for some changes? And in both of your analysis on capitalism in the past, you have always insisted on the fact that capitalism was conditioned, limited, constrained by the fact that there were actors who struggled against. So it was democratic capitalism, not because, to a certain extent, capitalism needed democracy, but it was because it was forced to by the trade unions and so on. Now, in that article by Stato and Mercato, you seem, Wolfgang, to expect changes, but at the same time, you say changes comes because there is no longer an opposition. And also in Collins, post-democracy, which we have discussed often in our times together at the EUI, he also seems to be more, can I say, nostalgic of the power of the trade unions, seeing with an optimistic eyes or a positive eyes social movements, but at the same time imagining them as quite fragmented and not capable of taking over the task of resisting the greediness of capitalism. Since your book were published, there were some changes. So there were anti-austerity type of protests which developed in the countries which were most hit by the austerity crisis, and unexpectedly, even by social movement scholars, they seem to have produced also some political earthquake, or at least beginning of political changes which are happening in Spain, which are happening in Greece. So how do you see the potential agency in a capitalism driven by banks, financial powers, and so on, but also capital which needs the decision-making powers of political institutions. And this calling has always been very clear. Neoliberalism is not produced by the market, it's produced by the states giving up powers, making decisions, cancelling laws which were there in order to constrain the greediness of capitalism. This set of questions I would like to ask you to address. I continue.
Well, there's a lot of questions there. and it was Lenin who first said that the best possible shell for capitalism was republican democracy, as opposed to a sort of very, his own kind of democratic centralism. And the argument is that capitalism needs a political system that guarantees the rights of private property and also guarantees a certain stability, and also probably something Lenin didn't think about with the capitalism of his time, but we can see it now, something that is capable of, and this is ordoliberalismus, I suppose, delivering the regulations that capitalism itself needs in order to function. So capitalism, certainly, and this is where there's a lot of crazy American neoliberals who really do think that you don't actually need the state even to guarantee private property, but that the whole thing could be done by private contract because there was this lex mercatoria in the Middle Ages whereby merchants managed to regulate themselves without the state's help. And it might well work in a medieval economy, but based on face-to-face regulations, whether it could work in a global economy is quite another matter. But most sensible neoliberals would accept a need for a certain amount of public regulation. There was that extraordinary intervention last week from the main banks in Europe, including the criminal banks, which is most of the banks, saying, we need regulation. You can't expect us to cope with this capacity we have for wrongdoing ourselves, because if one or two are opportunistic and take advantage of the honesty of the rest of us, then the honest ones will lose. So we cannot be honest by ourselves. We need external regulation, which all sociologists know is true. No system can regulate itself entirely by its own rules. It has to have something outside of it that to regulate it. So capitalism needs certain kinds of regulation for its own sake and to enable it to function. Democracy, in general, provides the most likely stable regime of that kind. Not democracy of the kind that 19th century liberals feared, where there would be this mass working class that would be opposed to private property, but the democracy that we now know exists, whereby very oppositional forces very rarely get the chance to have power, where there are always political compromises. That provides a regime where the law changes in ways that is announced well in advance, where there's ample chance for consultation and therefore lobbying. And most capitalists would say they prefer that system. Even though they invest heavily in China, they are always slightly worried that it can suddenly go wrong there and that the Chinese government might suddenly change the terms of trade. That dictatorships are not normally willing to offer long-term stability. And everybody quotes the exception of Pinochet in Chile, which was a dictatorship that actually implemented a free market recipe. But the Chilean case remains unique, really, among neoliberal cases of being a ferocious, vicious dictatorship that nevertheless sustained a free market economy. So what actually capitalists want is post-democracy, my definition of post-democracy, where all the institutions are in place, the rule of law exists, but it all happens, all the democratic debate happens around the margins of a society which is really governed by the big economic forces, but where those rules ensure that there is stability and predictability. So it's post-democracy is the best possible show for capitalism. And this means that capitalists, certainly in the advanced systems that we have, capitalists are more likely to tolerate a post-democracy than they are to insist on the overturning of democracy. So they don't want, what you do is you force the Greek government, you force a democratically elected Greek government to sign things. You don't have colonels get rid of that government anymore. That's become far too crude. And although that is a dependence on something very fragile, and although all the things Wolfgang says are true about the dominance of capitalist interests at the moment, it does mean there is that some dependence on the society. Which is why I started off by talking about alliances and coalitions that neoliberals need, because they do actually have to come to terms with their societies. And that then does mean there are points at which they need to make compromises. And these can be various, you know, many kinds of different forces. And the only thing that Wolfgang said that I would disagree with is where in fact I end up on the neoliberal side, because I do think there, and I would agree with Reichling, that there are some institutions where, for democracy's own sake, it's best that institutions are taken out of the hands of politicians. Because politicians are not... The politicians say they are the incarnation of democracy, right? La démocratie, c'est nous. And that is what they all say. Whatever they do is... But actually, they are also people who are striving for their own aims. That if they could possibly change the definition of reality so that we would vote for them, then they would do that. And it's very important, for the sake of democracy, that politicians have a limited power to change the definition of reality. So I don't want democratic control, i.e. political control, of national statistical agencies or of national broadcasting media. And I don't actually want politicians to be able to manipulate interest rates so that things come right for a few months before an election, before they all go wrong again. So I'm rather inclined to say I do actually want certain aspects of central bank behaviour to be beyond the reach of politicians, just as I want a rule of law, and that's something in Britain, we don't really have a rule of law. We insist that Parliament is sovereign, and we don't actually fully accept the Rechtsstaat in Britain, and it's getting dangerous now. I mean, we've assumed that we're gentlemen and so we wouldn't possibly do anything wrong, but when you start to get a system where the sovereignty of law over the elected Parliament is not fully accepted, you sometimes begin to realise that things can get worrying. So I think that democracy itself needs certain protections from the people who claim to be its incarnation. But anyway, coming back to the main point, there are these points where capitalism has some dependence on the society in which it lives. And then the society has this capacity to talk back to it. And then we get into our analysis of classes and interest groups and so forth.
Yes, just a reflection. You wrote post-democracy, though, in a moment in which neoliberalism seemed to be winning, seems to be on the rise. And post-democracy seemed to be fit for that moment, because it was based on the idea, minimalistic forms, you wrote, of participation for the citizens, electoral accountability as the main instruments. Trust us, because we are skilled and have the knowledge to do things better than the people can do. And we will perform, and we will give you economic development. But this post-democracy discourse, which is very strongly supported also now by what have been called illiberal democracies or authoritarian democracies, like hybrid type of regimes. In Turkey, yesterday we had a debate on Gezi. Erdogan is saying, trust us, We have been elected, we represent the millet, the community, and we will perform in economic terms. The European Union legitimacy by the output tended to say the same, to look for this type of legitimacy. But in the non-death of neoliberalism, my questions, and now I address it more to Wolfgang, then we'll give also the floor back to you, is it still possible for these forms of legitimacy of post-democracy, of a minimalistic type of democracy, to survive in a moment and in situations in which the citizens do not seem to be any longer convinced by the idea that a minimalistic type of recognitions of electoral accountability is able to provide a success on the outcomes side. So when people are outraged because they say the politicians pretend to be skilled, but in the reality they are not representing our interests. So it is post-democracy would have been an ideal situation, but as Colin said, is fragile, and maybe in some parts of the world, even the world near to us, is no longer sustainable from the democratic point of view.
I would suggest to another building block in this analysis, and this builds on the question whether the production of legitimacy in our societies is still mainly achieved by the political system, or whether it has moved somewhere else. And there the notion of consumerism becomes crucial. With the sort of emasculation of politics, the center of the definition, as well as the satisfaction of needs, aspirations, has moved to consumer markets. Mm-hmm. There, Colin's big firms come in. Mm-hmm. So the strange thing is the frightening thing you can also say is that this dilemma of liberalism, which is old, goes back to John Stuart Mill in the 19th century. Namely, on the one hand, you need a strong state, but on the other hand, you need a state that is not abused, so to speak, by the masses for all sorts of stupid desires like steady employment or this sort of thing. Yeah. So how do you get this done? Well, in my own analysis, in the book, I describe this transition from Keynesian to Hayekian democracies, where in the unique post-war period, democracy was defined as a source of economic growth, precisely by its taking away from the rich and giving to the poor, and then the poor spend the money, and as a result, economy will grow. Moving over 40 years to a world in which it's almost self-evident to everyone that in order to get an economy to grow, you have to take the money away from the poor and give it to the rich, because there's two different people, two different kinds of people here, requiring two different motivational theories. At the bottom, they work harder if you take the money away from them. At the top, they work harder if you offer them more money, lower taxes, and so on. Two different races of people running, living in the same society. Yeah, that's the new political economy. So how do you accomplish? Hayek sort of has this idea that you have to define the institutions of a democracy in such a way that it will never be able to intervene in the outcomes of markets. In the book, I quote his latest version of this. It's very funny to read. So there's only one time in your life you can go to vote, which is when you're 45, the year when you're 45. And then you elect 1/45 of the National Assembly, which will sit for 5 years or something. And then without, the only people who are not supposed to be elected are trade union officials. They cannot stand for election. He says explicitly, because they do not have the proper long-term view of the economy. Here comes my sort of little retort on Colin's point about the judicialization of decisions. Yes, of course, it's all fine and good. I don't want to be sentenced for traffic violation by a committee of the Deutsche Bundestag because I'm known to be an inter-European, and maybe they will double the fine just for the fun of it. Yeah? but we both undoubtedly agree that the great disadvantage of trade unions when they were strong was that they were a popular movement able to distort markets to an extent. Of course, they always had to think about it, but there was no central bank that could tell them to shut up, sit down, and wait until they decide how much people should earn. And that was for very good reasons, because distributional decisions are political and not theoretical. So there's a distinction to be made, which is blurry sometimes. And it's an achievement of civilization that we have learned that certain things are not political and they have to be done by experts, but it's but we can drive it too far. Yeah. Then the experts will say that 25% of the population have to be in precarious employment for the economy to be able to grow. And this is what the experts in fact say.
And then they say, sorry, we were wrong.
Yeah. So no, we don't want this. But now I want to say something on legitimacy production. If you decouple the state from the economy and turn it into a strong state that watches in the Hayekian way the economy or protects it from indiscreet wishes by stupid people. So how does consumerism work? Consumerism is a big process by which the notion of collective goods is continuously debased. The goods that you really want are private goods, and they are specifically for you. Not a Volkswagen built in 1970. They all looked alike, except that they had some. They were the same cars, except that they had some different colors. Now your things are really engineered for you. It's sort of the celebration of individualism, that has an enormous attraction, because if you can go and buy something in a shop, the good that you want, as opposed to having to join a political party or organize a social movement for the equivalent collective good to be produced, it's much cheaper, much easier. Yeah, you don't have to spend your time with unpleasant people and meet with them and convince them that telephone service should be improved. The telephone service can be improved by the big telephone companies, and you go and buy your iPhone. Basta così. That's what it is. Yeah, and so I've described this in an article in a book, Colin, where we have articles in. I think it was in this, or it was in New Left Review. I forget my thing. And it is about sort of the replacement of citizenship by the market process. Why is this so attractive? Because, and here we have to talk about something that is not fashionable among people like us, about the close relationship between liberalism and libertarianism. Mm. The element of freedom, quote unquote, that is built into markets, at least on the surface. The element of freedom, you have the choice. The Americans basically say, America is a republic of choice. Yeah. And choice means individual freedom. And you are the master. You decide whether you have a Samsung or an iPhone. And this can be contrasted to a political game in which old-fashioned things like discipline, compromise, long debates on what is good for all of us, the definition of collective interests requires skills and effort and attitudes that are not at all required in modern consumer markets. Mm. In fact, consumer markets permanently denounce these virtues as superfluous or outdated or something that the Communist Party in the 1960s required of its members. Yeah? Now, no communism anymore, consumerism. Buy what you want. And I tell you, if you look at the history of advertisement, product design, and all, just very strange, it all begins in the 1970s, which is when the libertarianism of the 1960s met modern capitalism in the design departments of the large capitalist firms, right? And tell your generation that being able to choose from 50 different designs for your next running shoes is not democracy, and that it may well serve to fool you about the extent to which you control your own fate, individually or collectively. And I think the solution to the problem of how to live with democracy is two things. One is destroy political parties and trade unions, mm-hmm. and have Berlusconi perform in television. The other is to have all these wonderful shops that you see here, and so people can spend all their day dreaming about the next running shoes and forgetting to think about the good society. Maybe the good society then crystallizes in the next pair of shoes that you buy.
But. Last round from the table, then we open the floor also for the discussion. It seems that also this consumerist type of solutions to the problem of legitimacy requires a growing economy. In the sense that what we see now is rather than these values that in periods of economic boom were also related with the type of values of the middle class, of a growing middle class, could encounter challenges in class structures, in transformations in which the middle classes are disappearing. Mm-hmm. The middle classes as we used to consider them in the research on the 70s. Because if you look at the still existing research on classes, looking at Wolfgang suggested in his article on the methodological issues, so how to study contemporary capitalism, if you look at the concept of classes not only as related with the production, but also related with the cultural developments and so on. You have the old middle classes that tended to support the libertarian values. For instance, free professions, mm-hmm. the lawyers, the doctors, the architects, the engineers. They are falling victims of the development of neoliberalism with more and more concentration. They are losing their autonomy, yeah. and so they become something else.
Yeah.
If you take the public employees in the social sectors, that were also carriers of this type of left libertarian values, they are falling victims of privatizations and the end of the public sectors and the public services, as we were accustomed to consider them. So that the questions emerges again, and it is the, for the last round, of how these class transformations can also produce oppositions to this type of neoliberalism, the oppositions that Colling saw as quite weak in post-democracy, quite fragmented, but that in some cases in the 2011 movements and in their political consequences, Podemos, Syriza, these parties of the left, they were networked into sort of not inter-class coalitions, but more multi-class forms of coalitions in which you had the traditionally protected sectors who were losing autonomy, power, capacity to be represented, but also the more and more precarious part of the labor classes that were not able to organize into the traditional trade unions, but on the other hand, had maybe other resources for action, so other bases of solidarities, other types of networks that could be addressed. So do you still see these movements as very weak, or under which conditions do you think that they can grow? Because one of the experiences which we have often not studied directly because we have left to the area specialists, mm-hmm. but are also mm-hmm. relevant for us, mm-hmm. are experiences like Latin America type of movements that emerged under conditions of apparent dominance mm-hmm. of illiberal forms mm-hmm. of neoliberal capitalism, but were sort of able to challenge this type of development, not bringing about the end of capitalism mm-hmm. that you talk about in Stato e Mercato, but at least introducing turning points in the neoliberal mm-hmm. critical junctures, which seem to be a trend that couldn't be, that would not die in your analysis.
There's a bigger question behind what you're saying, and that you're asking, and that is, when do social identities become political identities, or when do they become relevant to politics? And usually, historically, that has happened when an identity is an issue of struggle over inclusion and exclusion. And the history of the late 19th and early 20th centuries is the struggle for defined groups, mainly classes, sometimes religions, to be included in citizenship, and a struggle by those already included to exclude those who are seeking exclusion. And the struggle between right and left is the struggle for inclusion or for exclusion. This means that if someone is a manual worker, they know they're a manual worker, they know that gives them their social, their friends, their social groups, a lot about their identity, their cultural pursuits. But it only becomes politicized when that becomes a key issue in a struggle for inclusion, and when that is remembered for a certain number of generations, that yes, we were the ones who were excluded. And of course, the early stages of that are extremely dangerous, and the history of class identities, to some extent, in an earlier period, religious identities, is a history of violence and suppression and murder and upheaval. But eventually, we get to this, what increasingly seems the sort of happy period of the early post-war decades, when all of that is still a fresh memory, yep. so that people have a sense of who they are, but they're not being killed about it anymore. Now, paradoxically, universal citizenship produces a world in which these struggles don't happen so much anymore. And so the new occupational groups of the services sectors, the post-industrial groups, don't experience their identities as having a political importance. They have an identity. They know they belong to certain kinds of groups, but that doesn't give them any political clues as to who they are. And so one gets this decline in political salience of social identity. And what looks to superficial observers looks like a decline of class, but what it is a decline in the struggles of inclusion around class. It leaves certain things left, though, and that then becomes interesting. It leaves immigrant groups and certain ethnic minorities excluded. And that becomes a very difficult struggle, because the struggle over inclusion and exclusion becomes one between very large native populations against very small minority ones. And that's why it becomes the struggle around xenophobia that we now have. And that's why that's so powerful, because it's one of the few of these identities that remains, but it's one that gives a very unproductive politics. There remain issues, I insist, around gender, and the fact that women still have, although women have been citizens for a long while, there are still certain barriers women have, and the majority of the people who work in these services sectors are women. So to some extent, the struggle of women is the struggle of the post-industrial lower and middle classes, but that I think still has potential. And then there are these other much more complex things, because one starts to get struggles over inclusion and exclusion from the welfare state, from labour rights, from certain kinds of employment status, which actually pit the old working class as insiders against the new outsiders, which is becoming a very, very dangerous struggle in many countries. So one can see a whole series of... There are some potential identities for politicisation, which are very interesting. Some of these are quite dangerous for society in general, and rather dangerous for a left-wing perspective in particular.
Yeah, then I couldn't agree more. This is for the political system of extreme importance, and the way in which it's not just immigration in terms of those that are already there. It is the virtual possibility of open borders in a global economy where the supply of poverty. Mm-hmm. is endless, and with it the supply of labor, mm-hmm. and the most important experience of the past that labor movements have made is that where labor supply cannot be regulated, there can be no trade unions, there can be no collective improvement. One thing that comes that is important for us analyzing this game is to take seriously the concerns that exist around the issue of now global migration, also because it is a problem, as Colin says, of identity formation. My shorthand formula for this is that money is the most universalist thing on earth. A dollar is a dollar is a dollar, whereas people come in particularistic shapes. They are Indians, they are Europeans, they are Germans, they are Swedes, and they happen to identify with this, quite unlike a dollar. A dollar is a dollar is a dollar. And so a financialized capitalist economy with a free flow of capital has an enormous organizational advantage over the populations of the countries that are included in this system. The action space of banks is basically global, whereas the action space of political movements is local, national. Raises some extremely important and tricky questions, both in normative terms as well as in political operational terms. In the latter respect, we see that Europeanization, quote unquote, comes together with increasing emphasis on sub-national identities, productive sometimes, maybe in a place like Scotland, unproductive maybe in a place like Northern Italy. But there's also other places. Catalonia is somewhere in between, I would think, normatively speaking. Yeah. But also very interesting, coming back to work that I've done, I don't know, 20 years ago, and Colin, of course, worked all in that same field, which is the idea that smaller political units have the capacity, or may have the capacity, to carve out niches in a global system by emphasizing inherited strengths and tailoring their way of production, their way of organizing themselves to demands in the global economy where they can thrive. Take Sweden, take Denmark, take in a, again, normatively somewhat more questionable way, Switzerland. Yeah, Switzerland. And they are small, but they know where they are, and they know who they are. There's all sorts of problems involved in this, over-specialization. Take the Italian, Northern Italian textile industries that we studied and held up as an example. But still, the question is how much diversity in economic terms as well as in cultural terms can political units internalize without losing their action capacity? It's a question that is often forbidden to ask, but it has to be asked in a global world in which the local is the only, however you now define the local, is the only place where political action can actually be organized, where you have warm bodies of the other, like the Americans say. Yeah? Mm-hmm. No, not just Facebook communications, but but people with whom you can meet in the same room, then you can march through the city and you learn something from it. Yeah, but in the same way in which people learned from strikes what it means to have power. Yeah, I had very good relations with trade unions when I was young, and I've seen this before my eyes. People who have never had the courage to speak up to their boss after a strike, they learned they can do it. Yeah? This learning experience is not possible via Facebook. It is possible through direct contact. Last word on so here we are in a world in which money is the universal force, and people cannot be universal. They come with the brand of where they come from. And in my debate with Jürgen Habermas on European integration, this is the big point. Habermas has a sort of Kantian view of people. People can be sort of stripped of their particular identities, and then they can sort of form a democracy where everybody is a democratic citizen. My view is that this is basically not just for practical reasons impossible. It will always be impossible because we develop differences. We have to manage differences. And then the amount of differences we can manage within a political action field is, I would say, limited. Final word on end of capitalism. My idea when I began to think about this was to dissociate the notion of the historicity of capitalism as a social formation from the existence of an alternative to capitalism. The capitalism to rot away does not require a Leninist central committee that is based on the southern tip of New York and then declares capitalism ended and instituted. No, it can rot away on its own, and there are many sort of signs that this system, that the social system cannot do what social systems need to do. And here I'm very close to Colin's introductory remarks. I only put it slightly differently. A functioning society must be able to provide its members with some degree of stability and predictability in which they can organize their lives, so that their lives be not as fluid as money, less fluid than money, more sticky, more traditional, where tradition plays more of a role than in a money market. This capacity to, and then is the question, how is such a capacity provided? There's a second element in the definition now of a capitalist society, that this production of order, and it is nothing but that, that this production of social order has to take place, if this thing is to be capitalist, through the unintended interaction of self-interested calculations of independent individuals. That's how much the individual vices turn into collective goods. The integration. We know that in order for this to be possible, capitalism had to play a trick. It pretended that the public goods came about like this, but actually there was a government behind it that made sure that this happened. Karl Marx is the, Colin mentioned these banks that want regulation, but let's go back I think it's chapter 23 of volume 1, on the working time. On the working day in Karl Marx, there where he ends in a brilliant analysis that capitalists want to put a limit on the number of hours workers have to work during a week because they want the workers to survive. But individually they cannot do it. So they have to go to the state and in part to the trade unions to have this regulation imposed on themselves, so that they do not destroy the resources that they need. This is the end of this chapter, where he all the paradoxes of collective action that our friend, what's his name, from the University of Maryland seems to have, claims to have invited. Mansur Oz, what he claims to have invented, he just sort of should have looked up volume one.
Yes.
It's all there. And my point is that these mechanisms that have enabled capitalism to turn private vices into public goods and provide some sort of stability to the people, to the societies on which capitalism was imposed, and it was imposed, that these capacities are dwindling. That may, however, be a different discussion for a different occasion. The immediate conclusion that comes from this is that we may actually be looking towards an interregnum, a period in which we do not yet know what the new order will be, in which a vast variety of projects come up, good ones, bad ones, in the Polanyian sense. Fascism was also a project of social order, as was socialism. And Polanyi is very conscious that in Gramscian terms, all sorts of monsters can arise in this world. My view would be, regardless of we call this pessimism or optimism or whatever, it's realism, and it will take some time until we know how this technological super civilization with its global extensions will in the future be governed in such a way that people will still be able to live with it.
Thank you. I would like now to open the floor for questions, and I would like to collect a couple of questions and then give back the floor to Colin and Wolfgang for answering. I also wanted to mention that for those who want to be kept informed about the initiatives here at the Scuola Normale Superiore, before you go, you can leave your email here. Rasmus.
Thanks. My name is Rasmus Hoffmann from the European University Institute. I am really grateful for all the wise and good things that have been said in the last 1.5 hours. I want to take up on the last few sentences by Wolfgang Strick that were slightly Eurosceptic. I see that the European integration is limited by the distance between the local level and the next government or the next parliament or whatever is the relevant level. But we cannot just stop there to say this. Isn't there another constraint, and that is the distance between this parliament or the government and the global level where some players are playing? And my visualization is that we have to find a compromise and stretch as much between the local level and the next level, for example, the European, because also the European level has to cope with global challenges, and then a single country is not able to face a company or any global threat, and that's why I'm pragmatically in favor of the European integration, although this is maybe not the most important topic for today. But if we talk about the solidarity also in financial terms within Europe, this exactly is the question where we are either in favor of European integration or not. So maybe this is a link to our topic anyway. Thanks.
Another question over there?
Yeah. Thank you. Yeah, thank you, Professor Strick and Crouch, for this really inspiring discussion or talks, set of talks. But it wasn't really a debate, so I think several issues are could be added to make things a little bit more controversial, especially with your last set of remarks, Wolfgang Strick, where you were going into Marxist analysis. So what I would really be interested in, this of course has often been debated, but it's really important for the questions at hand, is how much should we look at the 50s and 60s in Western Europe as the golden age of democracy? So you were often talking about the monsters that could come up, and now in the end you were also looking at, or quoting Polanyi on the possibility of a fascist re-embedding attempt of the free market ideology. So was this really the best, the ideal that we could imagine of embedding? And then is really neoliberalism the enemy, so to speak, or shouldn't we look at the crisis dynamics inherent in capitalism much more, and how capitalism over and over again has threatened the foundations of democratic projects? Just to make it short, but this is just one controversial aspect that should be mentioned in this room, I think. Thank you.
I can take another question.
Charlotte Haberstroh from the EUI. I have, thanks as well for this really enlightening, I think it was a discussion, so thanks for that. And I saw one conflict in what you were saying about the question of consumerism. And first of all, I have a question about consumerism and how it's compatible with the concept of neoliberalism. So is consumerism not also driving neoliberalism, Thatcherism, Blairism, and in one way, and not by the corporations that bring it in and then kind of induct it to the people, but by consumerism, that this was actually a political process that was possible? And in that sense, if this is the case, then isn't this the perfect coalition between neoliberalism and the left? And then why is the left failing?
I would like to give the possibility to both of the speakers to answer, and then maybe to make another round. So prepare questions if you have some. Maybe Wolfgang can start.
Yeah. One has to distinguish European integration, first of all, from European Monetary Union. I think Monetary Union is a complete disaster, and it will it won't be sustainable. Otherwise, I was always and I am a friend of European integration, but only in a way that is different from what people seem to imagine it should be. That is a centralized state or some sort of state, even democratic state. I think we need to think about a lot of inventive new ways of organizing collective interests. When I was in my with my book in the Netherlands recently, to where the Dutch translation was introduced, people had this slogan: "Superstate, no; cooperation, yes." I liked this. I was impressed, and it also sort of hangs together with the tendencies towards governmental decentralization that I mentioned in a lot of countries. And in Germany, interestingly, we have the advantage that after the Second World War, the Allies insisted on Germany having a weak central government and strong federal states, and this is actually quite beneficial in many ways. And as a result of it, you don't see a Catalonian movement in Germany, but the Bavarians would be quite ready to organize such a thing, and not just the Bavarians. You think about the state where I live, North Rhine-Westphalia. The previous North Rhine-Westphalian Prime Minister, Jürgen Rüttgers, who was a Christian Democrat and an important figure in the last cabinet of Helmut Kohl, a European such and such, he had this idea that North Rhine-Westphalia, being bigger than the Netherlands, should join the Benelux states as a fourth member. Because we're adjacent to Belgium, the Netherlands, and he hated Angela Merkel anyway, so he thought that he could sort of begin with a sort of Rhineland separatism, drifting to the west. Very interesting. The federal government immediately intervened and had this killed. I think there's lots of good ideas about European integration. But then, the argument that also Habermas often sort of, without thinking much, and Voltaire always thinks, but in this case, I think he hasn't really thought this through about the big state, like Europe becoming a global player like China, America, in order to defend the European way of life against the other big units. I think that's essentially mistaken. Europe is not capable of playing a game as a big global power. In fact, it is quite questionable whether the Americans are. And it is quite questionable whether anybody else is. And whether the real question of Europe is not the question of the slow decline of the fourth hegemon of the capitalist system, Florence, Amsterdam, London, Washington, New York, Washington, the slow decline of the United States, and the question of what in the world is the new global order, where you have on the fringes of the empire an increasing number of failing states, and where there is no central hegemon anymore who can run this place. Very interesting question. And it is in this context that I would discuss the question of European integration. How does Europe fit in it? Also in terms of money, incidentally. But that may be another story. And one misunderstanding I really want to address, which is I've never said, and Colin has never said, I'm sure, and I know, that the 1960s or 1950s were an ideal time of democracy. In the same way in which not even classical Athens was an ideal time of democracy. They had lots of slaves and women who were not allowed to show up in the agora when they deliberated, yes? But my point is simply, on our point, I would say, is simply that this was a period in which, after the experience of you have to see this in the context of the complete disaster of the first half of the 20th yes. century. When there was a war in which, I think, I always forget this number because it's so horrific, 60 million people lost their lives. And in which there was the world economic crisis of a dimension that hopefully will never come back in the 1930s, in which there was the clash of different centers and would-be centers of the expanding capitalism in the First World War. All of this ended 1945 with a few wise decisions for a period of 30 years when I call this in my book, I call this the reissuing of the hunting license for capitalism under strict conditions. Yes, you're allowed to go and shoot for profit, but you have to deliver something in exchange, which is economic growth, stable employment, the prospect of improving citizenship for everyone. Yeah? And so on. Look at the list. Sometimes you think it's a sort of radical communist manifesto, but it was the collective agreement after 1945 in our Western countries that this is the society that capitalism has to deliver, otherwise capitalism is no longer worth having. And it lasted roughly three decades. And this is what we call the golden age. Nothing else. Right? That in Germany and other countries, homosexuals had to go to prison in the 1960s rather than get a marriage license at City Hall. We know. Yeah, that doesn't have to be told. But that's a different game. The thing I'm talking about is 30 years of roughly, by and large, peace. End of the Civil War in U.S. The Civil War, okay. Consumerism, yeah. I think consumerism is in alliance with neoliberalism, and in many ways, I think that the cultural aspect of the stability of this self-destructive system, or let's say, the lack of capacity of the citizens of this system to prevent it from destroying itself at high cost for everyone, has to do with the obsession that has been generated in people with this sort of enormous supply of consumer goods, which are good for nothing, except for make you feel better. Yeah. But feeling good is not a guarantee for social stability.
Thank you. Yeah, certainly continuing what Wolfgang was saying about the 50s, 60s, and 70s. I mean, that goes on.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. It
might not have been a golden age. It was a silver age. I mean, for the reasons Wolfgang says, especially in comparison with an appalling first half of that century.
Yeah.
And also continuing a point he just started to touch on, those decades were really good, particularly if you were a heterosexual white male with no disabilities. People outside that minority, life has in many ways got much, much better during what has been a kind of a joint neoliberal social democratic hegemony against traditional conservatism. Mm-hmm. It's been an unspoken kind of alliance, but because history doesn't move in very clear waves. There's a continuation of certain things that come out of the first three post-war decades, continuing in a certain kind of liberalizing strength, joining with also the neoliberal strategy of breaking down a whole series of barriers, because neoliberalism, or neoclassical economics doesn't recognize gender or ethnicity or sexual orientation. I mean, there has been a very benign, unspoken, unofficial coalition of neoliberal and social democratic forces that have made our world a lot better in a lot of respects, during a period where, in other ways, it's been getting worse. And there's something Wolfgang wrote recently somewhere that, in a way, we're now being fobbed off with thinking that we can have a democracy about how many rights lesbians get, but we're not allowed to touch the power of big corporations. So in some ways, we're being fobbed off with this kind of politics, but it's also been an important period for a lot of people. I don't want to get drawn into the European integration debate, because that is a different debate, and that's where Wolfgang and I would disagree. but it's another day's discussion. But in that context, just want to take up one point Wolfgang was making about the importance of particularities and how the Danes are able to have their niche in the world because they're a small group that organize around a certain skill set, so forth. Yeah, that's true, but it's also true that certainly at the economic level, and I'm going to make this political in a minute, the economic level, an enormous amount of innovation comes from the encounter between two things that are different. And the Californian economy does not produce an amazing amount of scientific innovation because of the wonderful quality of the school system. It does it, which isn't very good. It does it partly because of the enormous amount of state investment, actually, in the sectors that are predominant in California, but they're not allowed to say that in America. But also because it recruits people from all over the world. So scientists from India and Japan and America and Germany and Britain meet and bring their differences, and that makes a possibility for new things. And you see it more obviously in fashion and food, how the encounter of difference. It makes a new particularity. So we all have these particularities in our societies, but these are actually changing.
Yeah, yeah.
And there's a English football song that has a line in it somewhere, and we all eat vindaloo. Now, vindaloo is an Indian curry, but it became a kind of national dish, partly because it rhymes with 4-4-2, which is the only way we know how to play football. But so this Indian dish became a part of British working class male identity. And so our identities change all the time. And now, that's a point about economic innovation. But it's a kind of meta level that's also relevant to this question about capitalism and whether it threatens democracy and its reproducibility. And it's a point I think Wolfgang has really made, well, it comes out of his discussion of Hayek, even if he doesn't make the point. The capitalism has actually been dynamic when it itself as a system has had to cope with challenges to itself. If you get a pure Hayekian system, whereas Wolfgang has revealed to the world, actually, because people didn't realize all this was in Hayek, you only get one vote, and that's when you're 45, and not if you're a trade unionist. You get a world in which there can be no challenge to the system itself. So this is a theory of the economy that is all about competition, which excludes competition with itself. Right? So. Capitalism has been most creative when it faced the challenge, actually, of the Soviet Union in the 1950s. People many people in Western Europe were looking over their shoulder at what looked like actually quite a successful system. It was very important that capitalism in Western Europe made a lot of compromises. Scandinavian social democracy was not interfered with by the United States. And capitalism itself was refreshed by the need to keep running against its challenges. It had to prove that it could produce a welfare state that produced security to workers' lives. And as Marxists always say, it is no coincidence that, following the decline of challenge, so capitalism has become far more arrogant about the way it treats working people. And see, if it really loses its need and its capacity to deal with challenges, then it itself starts to stagnate. And that's another reason why I say capitalism actually needs us, right? And it needs us to work, it needs us to buy its stuff, and it needs us to stimulate it. And the final point, on consumerism, yes. And Wolfgang really explained this already very well, that one of the things consumerism does is to exclude, or to try to exclude, the concept of the collective. Now, I don't mind consumerism. I mean, I buy a lot of stuff, and I like buying stuff. So it would be
hypocritical. Also shoes?
Sometimes shoes. Yes, at the moment they're letting water.
So I can't be
an ascetic sort of San Francesco and say I don't believe in consuming products. But the important thing is that my individual capacity to consume is dependent on certain collective things being in place. And the conflict between individualism and collectivism is really not the one that it was when it was a kind of state socialist definition of the collective that excluded the individual against an individualism that was pure individualism. It's the fact that as individuals, we can only consume and do other things in our lives given that certain goods are available to us that are made by our collectivity. Now, some people, the top 0.1%, are unfortunately able to exclude themselves from the collectivity. They can even provide police services privately, and they don't actually need to encounter the 99.9% outside. And the danger is that it's as they get more and more power and wealth, so their collectivism, that is a collectivism just among themselves, starts to exclude the bigger collectivism. And that's really the issue of individual and collective. It's the need to understand that we can't thrive as individuals without the collective.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Yes.
Kvanch Atak from the UI. I have a short question to both speakers here concerning the fact that the oldest sick and probably will die soon, but we don't know when the new will be born and how it will look like. So it's a kind of an interregnum period that's we are experiencing. And I'm just wondering if we are waiting for a set of new ideas or paradigm which will tell us how the new will look like. And I'm tempted to say that actually the ideas about a more fair and just society are actually circulated around, but maybe we're not enough convinced by them. Or are we maybe waiting for a structural change in an abrupt manner or in a kind of evolutionary fashion? So just hope for your reflections on this.
Thank you. I've added two questions, Lorenzo there, and Helge.
Thanks. So very briefly, Lorenzo Mosca from SNS. I really like the discussion and learned a lot listening to you, but also ended up a little depressed. Because it seems that virtually capitalism is colonizing every space for contestation. So I would like to push you a bit in the direction of some questions that Donatella did before. Did you see some room for critical thinking, critical kind of consuming, critical media? There are some groups that are also doing political consumerism, creating groups, building, buying local productions, or engaging in the creation of critical media. So producing non-commercial and non-standardized media products. There are groups of civil society making pressure on the international level to bring changes at the domestic level, the boomerang effects, like someone calls it. Did you see some space for change, or everything is functional to the reproduction of capitalism? Just to go back to my home and don't be so depressed in the end. Thanks.
Thank you very much for a most interesting and stimulating intellectual dialogue from the panel. And also thank you very much to other interventions from the audience, which have carved out some tensions, not between the speakers, but within the argument of each of the speakers. I would like to continue the same tendency as others have done here in the writing by Streck in Stato e Mercato. It was some reflections about how the perception of the past is changing in hindsight, and the period that previously looked like considerable gains now may look like a period of constant crisis. It might also apply to the so-called golden age of Western social democracies that has just been discussed regarding the minority of white heterosexual Western males who enjoyed lots of benefits in that period. I will remind that during the process of decolonization, which started in the 1950s and 60s, often the knowledge looks quite different in hindsight when knowledge is also being decolonized together with the politics, both in external colonies, for example, where Frans Fanon was active and gave a different view of European history than what the Europeans had previously told, also in Indian subaltern projects studied. Subaltern studies project. Also in internal colonies, like the indigenous area in the Scandinavian welfare state, which was colonized until the period that was the end of social democracy, golden age, end of the 1960s, which was also the beginning of the implementation of indigenous people's rights in the area. With such changes where things in hindsight look differently from what it looked originally, I would invite the panel to reflect like they did about European integration, but at a global level, about the possibilities for global social integration and global joint struggle with marginalized minorities in the richer countries together with the marginalized majorities in the poorer countries.
Very short question, please. Georgia?
Yes, it was striking for me to listen to consumerism being in juxtaposition to a participation in collectivities, because in the 50s, the 60s, or the 70s, the big trade unions, for instance, in Germany, were those of the workers in big industries, and the big industries were flourishing because of consumerism, where every German household got a washing machine, a car, so on and so forth. So I was wondering, coming back to what Colin Crouch said in the end, I was wondering what are the conditions for the coexistence of consumerism and collectivity and participation in collectivities. And then a second remark was about the initial discussion about the European Central Bank, Mario Draghi, the German government, the national governments. I was wondering to what extent it was different in Germany in the 60s, 70s, or 80s when there existed also an independent bank, and to what extent the relations with the government was different then. And finally, a small remark. I've been watching carefully that bag over there on the chair, and I think it's a Samsonite one. And then I remember Colin Crouch's remark that neoliberalism and consumerism can be a very kind of popular way of living. And then I thought what the Americans say, that the mecca of neoliberal capitalism, that you vote every time you buy. And then I've been wondering to what extent we vote every time for neoliberal capitalism when we act ourselves in our lives as consumers.
Okay, thanks. I have very two short questions. The first question is on I want to bring back the discussion to the end of capitalism. Basically, it seems to me that there is a sort of, I would say, mismatch or different analysis between your analysis of capitalism as a historical formation, where you place, both of you, I guess, struggles as one of the main concepts, or at least the concept of power relation as central, and this was also central in the production, and is also in the achievement of the welfare state, also of the so-called glorious 30 years. So you basically, in all your books and work, you emphasize this side. But then it seems to me the little bit this dimension of the say of evidence, say agency is missing in your analysis of today's extinction of capitalism. So what I want to ask you is how, actually, this is also a follow-up question because the other three people more or less issue this question, how you can see room for agency in this transitional phase, because it seems to me that otherwise you have a little bit deterministic, to a certain extent, analysis. Yeah. And the second question is more for, I would say, social science, in the sense that, okay, we are all real social scientists, oh, okay, we're young PhD students, and we do, you are a star on this field. The question is how we can study capitalism, because it's true that we have been missing with these big concepts, big theories over the last 30 years because many reasons, because of the hyper-specialization of the discipline, because of very strict disciplinary boundaries, because we didn't use anymore these concepts. So how we can, if we should bring back this concept, we should also, I guess, cross the disciplinary boundaries of many disciplines in order to grasp capitalism, because it's a totality. So I don't think, epistemologically speaking, we can grasp this phenomenon through a very specialized discipline, like can be social movement studies, political economy, and so on. Thanks.
Thank you. Wolfgang?
Yeah, I'll try to be short, because we've been invited for a drink after this
you came
after this event.
Consume your drink.
And the drink is always the crowning of the session. Now, I begin with ideas, and I've last year begun to read about money and about different regimes of money, and I was struck by the fact how variegated and rich the debate about the proper institutionalization of money was in the 1920s and 1930s. There were sort of enormously interesting ideas in the world, and there was this genius, John Maynard Keynes, who was able to not just understand all this, but also to popularize in clear words, so to speak, how this debate could be made useful for practical purposes. I don't see this sort of thing today, from which I conclude that our social sciences are not doing the society the kind of service that they should be doing. We should be much, much more original, much more daring, think with much more courage. And we know how social sciences have been tamed. I was running a major research institute for 20 years. And I know about the constraints that people face when they look for jobs, and the pressure for specialization, and the pressure for shutting up on all important questions, and simply demonstrate that you're able to apply perfect technology to questions that interest nobody. Yeah? And then you get into the journals, and then you get a job. We have struggled against this. The people you see here on the podium have never subscribed to this ideology. We have been instrumental in organizing a scientific or professional organization called SASI, where we have tried to cultivate a style of the social sciences that brings together sociology, political science, and economics, and that tries to revive the traditions of the 1920s and 1930s, when political economy was done as a historical and institutionalist discipline, bridging the gaps between what now are the disciplines. Those of you who feel strong enough to do this are really encouraged to contribute to this sort of movement. We can no longer deliver a service to society by doing a sterilized sort of social science that simply reproduces the existing world and has no ideas about history, power, normative questions of a good life. So look at the giants. Keynes, Schumpeter. Schumpeter was an unpleasant conservative at the end of his life, but he never forgot that economics is not simply for economists. So that leads me to the question from the gentleman from the Scuola Normale Superiore on critical thinking. Yes, and is there space for change? My answer is seeking that change, that space, is not incompatible with being depressed. Sometimes being depressed is a good stimulus to take things really seriously. We are in a very difficult period, damn it, and we may not want this to be the case, but I personally am convinced that 2008 was not the last event of this sort, and that it can happen any time. And I'm also deeply convinced that the disorder that we see, what I call on the edges of the empire, first of all, is there to stay, and in addition, it will slowly hit into the center. So be prepared for this, and study the questions that are related to this, and take your own job seriously. And then you can be both depressive and productive. Depressed and yeah. Then tensions in the island. Yeah, decolonization. Absolutely, I absolutely agree. In the story of the 1950s and 1960s, we need to figure in all the sort of deficiencies or crises with which this was. I will not, however, withdraw from at least one marginal, the positive memory, and memory is important. In that's another thing. Incidentally, if you get older, you've seen more, and if change proceeds slowly. New generations are born into a world which they think is the way the world always was, and how it basically should be. That's not the case. We're talking about long-term change, and if there's one thing that is sort of in my memory, and if you look at the history of the 19 of this period, very important. It was an era where a general promise of progress was essential for the legitimacy of these societies, not just inside the empire, but also outside. Decolonialization, the building of states, mostly states that saw themselves as socialist. Socialist and anti-religious, in the sense that they were trying to be modern states with modern citizens. And the hope that was linked to regimes like in Egypt and Syria and elsewhere, were extinguished not just by the forces of tradition, but increasingly in the 1960s and 1970s, politics and policies of the empire itself. Absolutely. The 1970s are basically a period when the hope for progress sort of clashes with the feeling of those in power that this has gone too far and that one has to put a brake on it. Chile. The Compromesso Storico in Italy. And you can mention many other such moment when those that were running the place decided that they had to do something. And it can be found in historical documents. There's no, they have no, made no, no silence about it. They spoke about it. Consumerism, yeah, this is, no, consumers, of course, the consumerism society begins in this period when every family sort of was able to buy a washing machine. But what I'm talking about is something slightly different, or really then qualitatively different. A world in which the beginning saturation of basic needs had to be fought by new forms of product design and product advertisement and product communication that kept the process of consumption going in spite of the fact that it has long got out of touch with the fundamental things that had to be rectified in these three decades. Now, the amount of money that producers of consumer goods put into advertisement and product design has astronomically increased as opposed to the production cost. Half of the population here, I think, sometimes goes and buys a perfume for themselves. This costs nothing to produce, but it is the image that is being. So when consumerism begins, it is sort of the movement from material needs to image production, and that has something to do with identification. Mm. That has something to do with politics. Mm. That has something to do with who are we? Mm. Yeah, rather than what do we need? And this whole machine sort of functions only if we can persuade you that you need something of which you never expected that you would need it. And there is where consumerism really kicks in. If you read the books of the marketing discipline, sometimes you find a very strange sort of chapter at the end. When will we lose the capacity to make people buy things that they don't need? Think, God, what a terrible prospect, what a terrible moment. Let's do all we can to keep them buying. Yeah, because then it's like imagine it's war and nobody comes. Or imagine it's Christmas and nobody goes shopping. So and this also on agency. In my view, we're in a world in which we can't say what is the right thing to do, what will build a better society. There we may need a Hayekian market. Lots of people are trying different things, and in the end, it may sort itself out. Some will help and others won't, and there's no guarantee. So again, if you become depressed about this, go to a psychiatrist, but that's the way it is.
Yeah, that most of the questions revolved around the same issues as the capitalism's capacity to vary the scope for agency and action, and or as someone put it very succinctly, is everything functional or is there space for contestation? Yeah. And because you can earn quite a good living as a social theorist by proving how everything is functional, and because you can show even opposition is functional. But if you want to do that kind of work, you must be willing to produce counterfactuals and say what would constitute an example of an action that wasn't functional to the system. Because this is especially important when analysing capitalist societies, because capitalism's great advantage and great characteristic has been its capacity to keep changing, to keep transforming itself. The state socialist system in Soviet Europe couldn't do that. As soon as someone like Gorbachev arrived, the thing just collapsed within about 3 years. Now, China's a slightly different case. Clearly something is adapting there. But capitalism has long-term shown its capacity. And Maynard Keynes is an example of this. I mean, Keynes believed in the capitalist economy. Now, he refused even to associate himself with the very limited socialism of the British Labour Party of the 1930s and 40s. And what he was doing was saving capitalism. He was producing a form of economic management that gave the state certain instruments that kept it at a distance from the details of the market economy. And it wasn't a system for a planned economy at all, it was a system for limited intervention. So at various times, capitalism has shown this extraordinary capacity to change, adapt. And it might continue to do that. I say might because of two worries I have, one of which I've already mentioned, and that is that its capacity to adapt and change has been dependent on its need to confront opposition. And if it manages to get rid of all opposition, then it ceases to have the need to challenge. And so therefore every protest movement, every challenge, every disruption, every difficult group of people helps capitalism sustain this capacity to be flexible, which is in all of our interests. Probably the most important thing of all was something we haven't mentioned today, and that is forcing politicians, business interests, everybody in power to confront climate change and the challenge that is to our human life here. So green movements everywhere are forcing, where they can succeed, are forcing capitalism to do this. The other worry I have, apart from all opposition being stopped, is I've lost my point now. Never mind. I'll think of it in a minute.
Very good.
I didn't. All right, it's gone. So I'll let me move on to this. So will you? Anyway, so it does mean opposition movements are worthwhile because they do produce this. I've thought of the other point. There is a tendency at the moment in the kind of neoliberalism we have, which paradoxically is a very political neoliberalism, there is a kind of tendency to almost to reproduce, well actually it reproduces Mussolini's concept of totalitarianism very more effectively than he could do, and that is that notion that because we're in a series of national economies competing in a global market, government has to make sure that we all are as competitive as possible all the time. And so, for example, young people should see their education as being about how to be very competitive in getting jobs so they can be very productive in jobs and earn a lot of money and help the national economy. And education is nothing to do with learning how to love literature or appreciate science for its own sake. So there is a kind of driving out of anything that's non-instrumental. And that's enough, that is a kind of implicit totalitarianism in politicized neoliberalism that is worrying. Because the beauty of liberal capitalism, that sort of classic market capitalism, is it leaves a lot of spaces. It only occupies certain spaces in life, and it leaves other areas free for us to produce opposition or just alternatives. And as increasingly, especially in a post-industrial society economy, capitalism needs to find more and more areas of life to make a profit out of. So it wants to colonize more and more areas of our life. And so capitalism has had this wonderful flexible capacity. It's in danger of losing it for these two different reasons. And it's up to all of us to do all we can to challenge it, not to overturn it, because we won't. Unless something nastier comes, as Wolfgang hints at the end of his book, but to keep its own capacity to be responsive. And because I make a similar point in response to the issue of consumerism, consumerism is compatible with collectivity if, as I said earlier on, we see our capacity to run lives in which we can consume and make choices as being dependent on our membership of a collectivity that has certain needs. But then there's a second thing that is more difficult, and I know Wolfgang was dealing with this in his comments, that, again, as capitalism needs to colonize more and more areas of life, so it forces a consumerist model onto more and more things. So the consumerization of childhood, for example, is a very important recent example. The importance here is to try to resist it. and to teach our children to resist it, when we've got children, okay, you can get pleasure and fun out of buying a new thing, but you can also get pleasure for going for a walk in the woods, which doesn't cost you anything, unless it's a private wood. And gradually, they will privatise the woods. There was a very interesting working class movement in Northern England in the early part of the 20th century for the right to roam. People living in the cities wanted the right to walk through fields and across the hills. They didn't want to spend any money doing it. They didn't have any money. They wanted to walk. And they had problems because private owners wouldn't let them onto the land. And there was a big and successful movement for the right to roam, which was not a right to consume. It was, in a way, a right not to have to consume. So it's very important to maintain that. But that all one needs to do is not to fight the idea that we can get pleasure from products, but just to maintain the idea that there's a lot of things that don't need to be made into consumer products to be enjoyable. And that, in the end, does come down to all of us and our relations with each other and with our children, people we know, just to insist that there's more to life than the shops.
Thank you to both. When I thought about this project of a series of encounters on neoliberalism in the crisis, I had no doubt that I wanted to invite Colin and Wolfgang. My only doubt was together or separate. And I think that the option of having them both together helped us also to go even beyond the books and to start to discuss also about new things. We will continue to do this, and from these discussions I got a lot of answers but also some new questions. And one of these is on reflections in general on capitalism. We tend to reflect about it in terms of a binary, yes or no type of things. Mm. But maybe, and in this we risk to enter into a paradox, that if we don't want capitalism, we just do nothing, wait, no opposition to capitalism, and capitalism will end. Mm. But maybe a way instead to look at it and also to the past is not that capitalism was so successful in adapting itself, but that movements produced the movements, what Polanyi would say, more in the direction of social protections, so in the directions of less free market and more social protections, and it was precious. We discussed the fact that in the development from the so-called 30 Glorious into nowadays, some rights improved, some rights increased. Mm. And these were the rights which were at the basis of protests, contestations, movements, so on LGBTQ, gender rights, but also minority rights, and so on. So that movements had been successful in changing things. Maybe one could say not in letting capitalism survive, but in introducing other element in the society. And I think also these reflections on different consumerism, different enclaves in the societies in which different principles of solidarity rather than of competition, of collective rather than individualism survived, is something which was achieved thanks to mobilizations, and that now maybe some of the protests which we see developing in some areas of the world are protests that are bringing back in also the needs to push societies more towards recognitions of solidarity, collective identities, and of the importance of some corrective to capitalism. So I think this is materials for maybe a new working group of Marxisms next year, for sure for inviting again Colin and Wolfgang in the next months and years. And I want to thank you all very much for this interesting discussion. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.